Well, good morning, Walnut Village. I trust you had a good Thanksgiving, that your food was delicious, that even though it was different this year, you had time to remember and to think about things that you were thankful for. Let me start today with a strange question, but hopefully it will make sense to you as we go along. Do you have any enemies? Have you ever made enemies? Who do you consider an enemy? Well, our dictionaries tell us that an enemy is a person who hates or opposes us, a person who tries to harm us, someone who would do something that hurts us or damages our reputation. The Latin word inimicus means hostile, unfriendly, and it's the root word of enemy, and it comes from the prefix in or not, an amicus, which is friend. An enemy is not a friend. Therefore, an enemy is any person hostile to you. Now, you may be thinking this is a strange way to open church, but what we have seen develop these past years is a catastrophic growth in the disagreements over politics, personal beliefs or practices that become so sharp that people now have enemies they never had before. In fact, you may have enemies based on this definition that you're not even aware of. And this is like a cancer eating away at our relationships, our communities, and our friendships. How damaging can this be to our society or our churches or our families or our relationships? We have no idea. But there is this one remarkable thing, and it's this. Jesus came and died for his enemies, you and me. The Apostle Paul talks about this amazing action by Jesus in Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 8, when he says, "It was while we were powerless to help ourselves that Christ died for sinful humanity." And it is a rare human experience for one person to give his life for another, even if the latter be a good person, though there have been a few who have had the courage to do it. Yet, and listen to this, the proof of God's amazing love is this, that while we were sinners, his enemies, Christ died for us. He did not die just for those who honored him. He died for those who dishonored him as well. Now that is some kind of incredible love shown us by Christ. That's something to give thanks for. But it leaves us with the question this morning, how will we respond to this great love shown to each of us by Jesus? Jesus died for us, when we were still his enemies, and that opened the door for us to have a relationship with God the Father. In doing so, it causes us to always be in a position where we need to confess and seek forgiveness, which is gladly given us by God. So this morning, let us pray our prayer of confession and forgiveness together. God, do the work, the great work of prodding my conscience. Work in me more profound and abiding repentance. Overwhelm me with godly grief and remorse for the things I have done which are not Christ-like. Let me repent with trembling and broken spirit, yet ever with trust in your grace and acceptance of your love, which is ever powerful and ever confident. Grant through these tears of repentance that I may see more clearly the brightness and the glory of your saving cross. Amen. And while the music plays, take just a moment or two for silent and personal confession.
Old Testament scripture today is from Psalms 101. I will sing of your love and justice, Lord. I will praise you with songs. I will be careful to live a blameless life. When will you come to help me? I will lead a life of integrity in my own home. I will refuse to look at anything vile and vulgar. I hate all who deal crookedly. I will have nothing to do with them. I will reject perverse ideas and stay away from every evil. I will not tolerate people who slander their neighbors. I will not endure conceit and pride. I will search for faithful people to be my companions. Only those who are above reproach will be allowed to serve me. I will not allow deceivers to serve in my house, and liars will not stay in my presence. My daily task will be to ferret out the wicked and free the city of the Lord from their grip.
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on our way. While we do His good will, He abides with us still, and with all who will trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not a burden we bear, not a sorrow we share, but our toil He doth richly repay. Not a grief or a loss, nor a frown or a cross, but is blessed if we trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Then in fellowship we will sit at His feet, or we'll walk by His side in the way. What He says we will do, where He sends we will go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey.
Our New Testament scripture reading is from Philippians 2, verses 3 to 8. Don't be selfish. Don't live to make a good impression on others. Be humble, thinking others as better than yourself. Don't just think about your own affairs, but be interested in others too, and in what they are doing. Your attitude should be the kind that was shown by Jesus Christ, who, though he was God, did not demand and cling to his rights as God, but laid aside his mighty power and glory, taking the disguise of a slave and becoming like men. And he humbled himself even further, going so far as actually to die a criminal's death on a cross. And from Mark chapter 10, verse 45, "For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve others and to give his life as a ransom for many."
Thank you, Annette. Well, we always unify around those common beliefs that we hold so dearly too. So let us say our Apostles' Creed together. We believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he shall come to judge both those alive and dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you, Mike. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father and gracious God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight. And thank you for being with us this morning. In your Son's name, amen. Well, did you know that the word Christian comes from the Greek word Christianos? It means little Christ. And that is what the accusers of Jesus' disciples used as an insult. Dripping with sarcasm, they would say, "There's the little Christ." So what was meant to be a jeer turned into an encouraging title that's helpful to those who know Christ, to identify with him and to identify with each other. But what a great historical irony that it is now a title that we try to live up to, Christians. Now, the Bible tells us that it was in Antioch, early on in the history of the church, that the disciples first were called Christians. But why did the enemies of the early church call the disciples Christians or little Christs in the first place? Well, it was because the believer's lifestyle was so clear and unmistakable that this name was assigned to them. Because they put into practice what they had learned from Jesus, they completely achieved the mission that had been given to them, and to us, by the way, to represent Christ and make him known to the world. So what do we ourselves need to do to represent Christ? Well, rather than joining the actions of the world around us, pummeling our neighbors with harsh judgments, deriding them for those things with which we disagree, maybe we need to give up our lives for them. As little Christs, Jesus commands us to what? Love our enemies. Jesus said, "Love your enemies," in Matthew 5:44. He said to his disciples, "But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." And then in Luke 6:27, we read his words again, "But to you who are willing to listen, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you." And of course, we cannot forget the words of Jesus on the cross, "Father, forgive them. They know not what they do." Love your enemies. Jesus loved Judas as much as he loved Mary. Jesus loved those putting him to death. Jesus does not want to lose even one soul. He loves us all and gave his life for everyone. Now, no teaching of our Lord's is more difficult than this. To love your enemies. To love your enemies is to give up the right to be offended by someone's criticism of you. To shed all thoughts of revenge met out to those who have wronged you. To ignore those who have slandered you. To resist the urge to denigrate those who have hurt you. Instead, we are to pray for or give assistance to those that oppose us, attack us, or hate us. Can there be any action more difficult than this? It is in the Sermon on the Mount, found both in Luke and Matthew, that Jesus teaches on the principle of loving your enemies. Love your enemies. Easier said than done, I can tell you that out of true experience. Well, in verse 27, starting at verse 27 of Luke 6, we read these words. They're very plain, very straightforward, but simple and hard to do at the same time. Jesus told those gathered, "But to you who are willing to listen, I say, love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who hurt you. If someone slaps you on your cheek, offer the other cheek also. If someone demands your coat, offer your shirt also. Give to anyone who asks, and when things are taken away from you, don't try to get them back. Do to others as you would like them to do to you. If you love only those who love you, why should you get praise for that? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you get complimented for that? Even sinners do that much. And if you lend money only to those who can repay you, why should you get accolades? Even sinners will lend to other sinners for a full return. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Lend to them without expecting to be repaid. Then your reward from heaven will be very great, and you will truly be acting as children of the Most High, for he is kind to those who are unthankful and wicked. You must be compassionate, just as your Father is compassionate. In this teaching of Jesus, which is recorded in Luke 6, Jesus answers three questions that we might ask. First, we may ask, Jesus, is this teaching for everyone? Will everyone try to follow this principle? Jesus answered this one. He said, no. To you who are willing to listen, those are the ones that can love their enemies, those who are willing to listen. Not everyone will listen. Not everyone has an interest in or gets spiritual things. In fact, the Apostle Paul tells us in his letter to the Corinthian church, the natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him. So don't expect everyone to love their enemies. The next question we might ask is this. Jesus, what do you mean by my enemies? Who are my enemies? His answer, those who hate you, threaten you, curse you, hit you, take what is yours. It's not that you make them your enemies so much as they put themselves in that category by their actions. These are ones you are commanded to love, not hate. And the third question, Jesus, how can I love them? I don't even like some of them. His answer again, Jesus did not command you to like them. Some of them he doesn't like either. He certainly did not like the Pharisees. He commanded you and me to love them. And in Scripture, love is never simple emotion. No, it's always accompanied by an action. Love is a verb. Love is something we do. When love is an action, we can love those whom we don't like. So when Jesus commands us to love our enemies, he has actions, specific and precise actions in mind. We are to do good things for our enemies. We are to bless our enemies, that is, say good things to them. We are to pray for our enemies. We are to ask God to do his will in their lives. And we are to give to our enemies. These are the four most basic acts of love. Would you agree? Do good, bless, pray, and give. And that is what we are commanded to do regarding our enemies. Now, for the most part, you try to do these things for your family and friends, and a whole lot more, of course. But these four actions are what the Lord had in mind when he called on us to love our enemies. If we as little Christs would obey this command of Jesus, it would be world-changing. Why? Because here's what happens when a Democrat loves a Republican. Here's what happens when a Jew can love a Muslim. Here's what happens when a white person can love a person of color, or a righteous person can love a sinner. Here's what can happen. God is honored. Jesus is pleased. The Holy Spirit is able to use our actions to accomplish his will. The devil is infuriated because you are not playing by his rules. The enemy, those who did the bad things to you, they are stopped in their tracks, puzzled. They fully expected you to retaliate and to do unto them as they had done to you. The critics of the church, they're silenced. They were all prepared to watch you respond to the bad guy with evil deeds of your own, which they would use then against you. But instead, you do the loving things, and they don't know what to do with that. The church itself is blessed as peace and joy is increased among its members. Christians going through hard times see your behavior and are inspired to do the same, no longer consumed by self-pity. Non-believers are drawn to Jesus because finally they see someone doing the same kind of things Jesus did. You yourself, you're blessed as anger and resentment are dissipated. And according to Luke 6:35, your reward in heaven is great. Nothing you and I will do in this life is more important than to show the love of Christ to people who get on our nerves, constantly harass us, persecute us for our faith, and attempt to make life miserable for us. This love is not natural. It cannot be done under our own willpower. It's supernatural and doable only by God's Spirit within us. Only the godly and the faithful to Jesus will do it. The rest will respond with lawsuits, attacks of their own, slander of their own, retaliation, bad words. But you know, Jesus understood this. If you only love those who love you, where is the power in that? Lost people do that. If you only do good to those who do good to you, where is the power in that? Unsaved people do this every day. If you give only to those who plan to give back to you, big deal. The world does this all the time. But if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, if you are a little Christ, you are not going to be allowed to retaliate. You will love your enemies, do good to those who persecute you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who threaten you, and give to those who would take away what is yours. Do that, do what Jesus taught us, and the whole world changes dramatically, changes for the good. You have his word on it. Amen. Let us pray together that prayer that is so familiar and so powerful, the prayer that Jesus taught us. Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We are little Christs when we follow Jesus, when we imitate him, when we read his word, when we walk closely with him. And one of the things that we do each week is we take the sacraments together, Holy Communion. Hear the words of remembrance then that come from 1 Corinthians chapter 11. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Take the bread now, eat of it, and while the music plays, focus on that sacrificial gift of Jesus on the cross. In the same way, Jesus took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant between God and you, sealed by the shedding of my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as oft as you drink it." And once again, take some time just to reflect on that wonderful gift of the cross and the ensuing resurrection. We do this, for every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes again. So in closing, may the God of endurance and encouragement continue to grant you all what you need to take up your cross and follow Jesus through all circumstances. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the powerful work within us so that we can love our enemies, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations forever and ever. Amen.